current FA's choice and methods of appointing the manager is poor. I really think that they should be asking the fans who should be the next England manager. I don't think they listen to the fans enough.
What is it? It's three blokes that are on the selection committee.
Yeah, I can't remember what background that and Barwick had. But
do they
have
to do with football? Yeah, exactly. I mean, what do they actually really know about football?
Selection process is all wrong.
Yeah. The way it should be done is that a sort of a fans poll should be done to get at least a short list of managers that the country actually wants.
So like a Big Brother style?
Sort of like a Big Brother sort of style thing, but obviously I think that's a stupid idea, Big Brother, to be honest. I mean, how you can do that?
I think that'd be awesome.
And put that into...
You get to see what they're like in their inside lives and stuff like that, as in...
As fans, are you really that bothered about that?
Well, yeah, we are, because basically you can employ the best man you think for the job, and then 2 weeks down the road, you can see that he's basically got an alcohol problem, or he's got some kind of problem, or something like that. And you find this kind of thing out if you were stuck in a house for like a week or so, being watched by the nation. Then you actually get to see what they're like on a day-to-day basis. And actually, they might be complete arseholes, and obviously you don't want that. And if you seem like a hard-talking, top bloke, then you might, that's how you want that.
Is that they handle the pressure, or having other people put pressure on us? We had to see through that.
What we're saying is that we don't want three people who we don't know their history about in football making the decision for the nation.
Yeah, I think that's basically what we're trying to say, yeah. And regardless of which route we're going to try and pick an English manager, I just think the bottom line is they should be asking the fans.
Yeah.
Generation of football fans is just being phased out because football is such a big business for the clubs now.
In order to stop this happening, we need new ideas to make them listen to us.
This isn't about the working class footballer anymore, whether that be the player or the fan.
It's been taken over by money. Money, 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 that's all it is at the moment.
The fans just get charged way too much.
Clubs aren't interested in what the fans think or want anymore. All they think about is what they're going to get in their pocket at the end of the day.
And gate receipts are continuing to rise and attendances are falling, and there's an obvious reason for that.
If you take a good look to your left and a good look to your right when you're next at a football match, have a think about how many children, how many teenagers you see at those games.
We can't go on like this.
The FA is getting pushed away, the fans are getting pushed away, TV and the clubs are taking over.
The day of walking into a local night spot and seeing a load of your local players having a great time has gone. It doesn't exist anymore.
Everything that they do is just for money. Money, money, money. And greed is not good. And that is the picture that the football clubs are painting. The greed is good, that's the picture, they're greedy, but I'm saying greed is not good. Should we take it the next level up and start with with the pinnacle of the managerial side of things, and like look at the EFA and the England job, for instance? Should we kind of try and see if we can persuade or make any decisions there?
Football has become expensive, meaning loyal working class fans have been effectively priced out of the game. And whilst the fans have voiced their concerns on this issue and others, such as fixture disruption, TV control, and the flagging English youth system, the general feeling from the fans, the lifeblood of football, is that they're just being ignored. Having foreseen the potential dangers ahead, Jason Ellis and set up the Fans Cafe, an organisation that campaigns for football to be more responsible towards its fans and to listen to their concerns on issues within the game.
I've always felt that, you know, the fans weren't getting treated correctly. You know, as you grow up, you see it more and more and more. And I wanted to do something about it. And I think the Fans Cafe, what we've set up, is probably the way we want to go and the area we want to get to. So it's kind of taking the fans' voice from every perspective. But what we want to do is we want to get the FA involved as well, because really the FA is a form of representation for the fans with regards to the football clubs and television and things like that, because they're taking over, and the FA should be doing something about that, but they're not, or they're not doing enough in my mind. So I think the Fans Cafe could work with the FA quite well in bringing the voice of the fan along to that and pushing them in the right direction.
The Football Association have a vacancy for a New England manager. A few weeks ago, the Fans Cafe pitched an idea to them to break ranks and let the fans help choose the next manager. But the Fans Cafe haven't heard anything back from the FA at all.
Yeah, what is the opinion of the fans? Mm. Mm. So the fans, and then roll all of that information up. Mm. So that you've got...
Morning everybody again. Well, good news and bad news.
Oh, yeah.
The good news is David here put a wonderful presentation together and a good business case.
But it failed.
Yes, that was the bad news, I'm afraid. Yeah, we tried to speak to the FA. We've been in touch via email, we phoned them up, we've even been knocking on the door. And surprise, surprise, they weren't interested. We didn't even get as far as actually speaking to anyone. We couldn't get past any of the secretaries. It was all in hand. They said, yeah, we'll talk to people for you. They'll get back to you. We didn't hear a thing. In the meantime, we've been out on the roads canvassing ideas and things from the public, from the fans. So one of the things that we've been doing is we've been asking them what they would look for in an England manager. They want somebody that's got some know-how, so obviously knows a bit about football at whatever level, but obviously has got some experience in either playing football, watching football, managing football teams, etc. They want somebody with a bit of experience, again going back to the managerial side of things. They want somebody that's got some passion, somebody that they can see is interested, somebody that gets excited. Yeah. So I think what we need to do is we need to take this forward to the FA now. So we already tried to kind of talk to them about getting fans more involved. But if we can somehow put something like this together so we can go to the FA and say, you know, this is what the fans are looking for, that's probably our next step, or that's something, you know, that we can take to them if we can't kind of...
Jason, take a voice. We tried going to the FA already.
I know, this is why I'd like to turn to you guys again. We need some ideas of what we can do, how we can get this across to them, or any other suggestions.
Jason's simple request to spend 30 minutes with the FA is proving to be a mission impossible. The FA's ignorance to the Fans Cafe hasn't dented their confidence. They remain defiant and have been building on their idea of having the fans select the next England manager.
Isn't it? So what's the difference?
I think what you need is a national competition. Mm. Fantasy football, whoever wins becomes England manager.
So you're talking about a fan being the manager rather than being a...
To win a fantasy football competition, you need to know which players to pick, you need to kind of change your team over, you need a tactic. Mm. What's the difference? I mean, six fantasy football leagues at the moment, bottom of all of them, so obviously I wouldn't be the next.
See, I've been top of mine.
There was only six of them. So.
Yeah, and you
but the guy is...
that's a very good idea, having a fan. You know, we could propose having a fan as a manager, as the next England manager, and that would definitely get a buy-in from the fans. As long as it meets the criteria of what the fans are saying.
Even if we said, look, we'll try it, six friendlies.
Yeah.
You know, what do we do in friendlies anyway?
Yeah. That's a good idea. Any other ideas of how we can pick the fan? So we'll go and have a chat with some marketing people, see if we can build the idea and take that out. And then alongside that, we need to get out there and try and find who this fan's going to be. So start taking the ideas forward. So well done, everyone. Brilliant idea. The Fans Cafe Group was created to help improve the relationship between fans and the football ruling bodies and the football clubs. We want to make sure that the fans are listened to and considered when any decisions are made by clubs or, you know, by the Football Association, etc. So we want to work with
all levels of fans. So we want to make sure that we work with, like, you know, at a club level or international level or whatever. There are some fans, or there are some, you know, fans at clubs already that are making a difference. We want to learn from those experiences as well. And we want to kind of spread the word about the fan base and the fan power, because, like I keep saying, that they have got a lot of power and they can make a difference, but they're not considered at all in really any decisions that are made. We wanted to make sure that they weren't just heard, but what the fans are saying is actually listened to, and something's done about it. If you think of it from another perspective, the fan is the customer of a very, very successful product, and in this case, it being football. And if you have a successful product, regardless of any industry that you're in, you want to make sure that the customer's happy with that product. You know, if you're not happy with your car, if you're not happy with something that you buy in a shop, you take it back, or you walk away, or you don't buy it. What would it be like if fans did that and walked away from football, or didn't buy tickets, or didn't turn up to the game? What would the game be without fans? So the message that the Fans Cafe carries is very simple. Consider the fans.
Hello, yes, can I speak to Brian Barwick, please? Yes, it's Jason Ellis from the Fans Cafe. Okay. Do you know how long he's going to be in the meeting for? Right. Yes, it's very important, actually. I've dropped him a couple of emails and I haven't heard anything back. I'm just trying to arrange some time to meet up with him. Yeah, obviously I know with what's going on, he's a very, very busy man at the moment. But yeah, no, I would like to, you know, just get half an hour or an hour to have a chat with him. Bit disappointing, still no luck, but have to remain upbeat. I'm a bit worried that they think that we're a threat, the FA, and that's why they're not getting back to us. That's my main concern now. We're not a threat to the FA. We want to kind of join forces with them. We want to kind of create an alliance. That's the whole point.
Fans Cafe found a fan deemed worthy enough to be championed as an England manager candidate. Jason has brought his team together to confirm the good news and to discuss the next stage.
Great news, we found a fan. You've probably all heard by now that it's Warren Bennett, so I just wanted to say, what do you think? You know, are you really pleased with who we've decided on? Or who the fans have decided on?
I don't really think it's for us, any of us around this table, yeah, to say, yes, we're happy, no, we're not. No. Will he stand up against the five factors that we talked about last time?
Yeah.
Well, we'll soon find out. Mm. But the main thing is that the fans have bought into it.
No, exactly. Yeah. Well, again, we've got this from the fans. Yeah, the fans considered, you know, deciding on who it's going to be. I think he's got all the criteria. Mm. So hopefully the fans are right.
I thought he was Scottish.
But what does this modest working class family man think about his appointment? Prior to his big match today, he spares some time to share his thoughts on his newfound responsibility.
Quite a good idea. I think, you know, fans do play a part, because after all, they're the ones paying the money week in, week out. Actually going to see the sport, so I'm kind of just wondering how it's all going to pan out. Still, if we have the next twin strike force here, at least I'll get, won't struggle to get a ticket, at least. Who's your high chair, Max? Can you get your high chair? Hey, you gonna get your high chair? It's about the passion and the knowledge. Also, you really want the desire and the will to win, you know. It's important, you know. Bill Shankly, you know, football's more important, you know. Football's more important. Football's not more important. That's what I remember. But yeah, you know, I've got the passion, got the desire. And basically, I want them to win.
Approach the FA and they're still not interested in listening to, you know, our ideas behind putting Bennett in charge of the England team, or putting a fan in charge of the England team.
Why not?
No, they're just not taking any interest at all. They think that we're just a little voice and we've got no say at all, you know.
Did they say that to you?
No, like second hand from the secretary, yeah.
Have you spoken to them directly?
No, I can't get through to them. They won't let me.
Still ignoring us.
Exactly, yeah.
You need to show them that he can make as good a decision as the current England manager, in a way.
Yeah.
So some form of comparison.
Some live experiment of some sort.
How can we do the comparison then?
Well, I think we've talked in the last sessions about
Bit for Daddy. A little bit for Daddy. A little bit of the toast. A little kiss for him. Thank you. You got a kiss for Daddy? Thank you.
You look
like.
Oh. Oh.
I can't get
the.
That was a poor section,
eh? It's got this idea of the experiment and a comparison, you know. Mm-hmm. Can we get something to run along during the World Cup with Warren involved? You know, if we can't get Sky.
Well, the World Cup's an ideal.
Exactly, it's coming up, yeah.
It's alive, it's on.
Yeah.
Well, so he's pretending he's the England manager at the same time, then, see?
Well, you could do it. You could run it virtually, couldn't you, really? I suppose you could get his opinions on the game, live opinions as it happens, yeah. So you could maybe, I don't know, have him in a studio or be interviewing him as through the game or after the game.
But then he judges him
on his decision.
Who actually then takes the decision?
Someone has got experience as well, like the pundits.
Yeah, because you need to have credibility from the people saying, yeah, he's the guy who knows his stuff.
Okay, yeah, I'd as well. Like Alan Hansen or something like that.
See, Ian Wright.
But then again, we've got to see him.
Yeah. The trouble is, you never find your trainers put down in one place and they're set up in another, aren't they? Let's kiss him. Let's kiss. Happy lots. Be good for mummy. Happy lots. Be good for mummy. Happy lots. Be good for mummy. Right.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Come on. In there, please.
Come on, Max. I'm not going yet.
Come on, fella. Give me those hands.
Come on, babe.
Good boy. Here we go.
Everyone in the lounge.
Make sure this way. Do you have fun at the ball? Itching to get on that football pitch.
They have fan zone technology, you know, you see it week in, week out. We click on the button and the fan's doing his commentary. This is just a different flavour of that. Rather than commentating, you're actually... If we're building on your idea,
we still need a way of judging him, don't we?
Well, again, we're going to need to get some buy-in and see if we can talk some professional pundits into commentating. If we can have or like judging him, if we can get Sky involved, then great. We've got some great resources there. But again, just names out of our hat at the moment. Who would we suggest? Who would be good people?
Hansen, Gray, we mentioned. You got
Shearer.
En route to today's very important match, Warren talks about his recent achievements in football.
The year before, the boys were struggling, and I've come here and I've turned them from relegation candidates to basically a promotion chasing team in the space of a season. We missed out, as it was, on the league title and goal difference, 5 goals to be precise, which. Still irritates me to this day, but you know, I wanted success. You definitely want to give it 110%. So finishing second, although a successful season since we did get promoted, wasn't quite what I wanted. But you know, I'm sure the boys would have taken that at the start of the season. That's the big job, isn't it? The England job. That's the one you want. No, you know, you can't be any prouder than leading your team. You know, managing that. Place of birth, you know, it's your country, so it's where you've grown up, you know. The void isn't really that big between, you know, professional managers and Sunday League managers. Well, at least I don't think it's as big as people think it is, you know. So.
We've some foreign pundits, like
Pele.
Pele,
imagine getting Pele. I think we might struggle with Pele.
It's
local decided to put the athletics track down before our last home game of the season. So I don't think the ref will be too happy seeing five lines where he should be seeing one, but we'll wait and see what he says when he turns up. Guess you could always have a athletics meeting instead.
If we can monitor, watch Warren during the World Cup, and we can perhaps take it or, you know, listen to him and his views on what should happen during the World Cup and his different opinions on each of the games.
Because he can, I mean, whilst he wrote...
That's a good idea.
Get some sort of psychiatrist. Or, I don't know if the word psychiatrist, but you know, a team of people.
No,
because you can tap into your brain. You get the issue because.
See the marketing teams, etc. Get them to kind of build up a business plan for us to take forward to the TV channels, the newspapers, the radio stations, etc. With this idea of the virtual manager, Warren Bennett, and you know, just take it forward from there.
Yeah,
I think that's what we need to do. Yeah.
In the early to mid 1980s, football in New Zealand was riding a crest of a wave. This was largely due to the All Whites' successful qualifications in the World Cup finals in 82. But towards the late 80s, the fans had become increasingly frustrated as the team marked one failure after another and were soon considered perennial underachievers.
One frustrated fan, Ernest Simper, became well known for his verbal attacks on the New Zealand FA.
Simper was a fervent campaigner. He wanted the New Zealand Soccer Corporation to make significant improvements to build on the successes of the All Whites leading up to the World Cup finals of 1982. He wanted an infrastructure that would help the All Whites qualify for every World Cup finals, not just to be content with the odd one.
Through his campaigning, Simper built up a large network of support, so much so in fact that in 1991 the NZS, under pressure from the fans, made a number of changes in response.
You know, the New Zealand Soccer Corporation recognises that, you know, the fans are something to grumble about, mate. We understand that, so we do hope that the changes we've made today will start making everyone bloody happy a bit. And it's certain idiots, you know, we'll stop blaring on thick and give us a break, you know. I mean, that's all I'm going to say about it today, mate, but, you know, give us a chance. That's all I'm saying, just give us a chance.
The changes the NZS made were just cosmetic. They were made in an effort to shut Simper up.
Ian Marshall was the coach of the All Whites. He'd invariably taste defeat more often than victory.
Simper and Marshall did not get on. Simper took exception to his coaching style and overall leadership. Simper referred to him as the arse clown, and they exchanged heated words on a regular basis.
In defiance to Simper, the NZS gave Marshall their full backing, reassuring all white fans that he would get the full assistance to help New Zealand qualify for the 1994 World Cup finals. And in preparation to the World Cup qualifiers, the All Whites toured England in February 1992.
Of course, this was during the English League season, and as a result, the All Whites were lined up against mostly reserve teams. The tour was a disaster. A 4-2 defeat against Southend, a 3-0 loss to Scunthorpe, and a 7-0 trouncing from Tranmere Rovers. Simper was furious. He wanted heads to roll, and Marshall was top of his list.
Simper argued that Marshall was an idiot and had to be replaced. Jokingly, he said that he could do a better job. In response to this, followers, sharing the same frustration, created a campaign to put Ernest Simper in charge of the national team. The fans trusted him to get things done, the way the fans wanted. The campaign captured the imagination of thousands of all-white fans, and it began to gain momentum.
In the May of 1992, the all-whites were scheduled to host German club side Werder Bremen in a three-match tri-series. The tour was arranged largely because of Winton Rufer, New Zealand's greatest football export, who was playing for Werder Bremen at the time. But what preceded the tri-series was probably the strongest demonstration in fan power there has ever been. Literally tens of thousands of all-white fans declared they would boycott the matches unless Simper was put in charge for the complete series.
The NZS took no notice, deeming it a ludicrous idea. They viewed it as an empty threat.
You know, let's not beat around in bushes here, right? You know, let's be honest with each other. You know, fans are a fickle bunch. They're not going to cut off their bloody noses to support their faces now, are they? You know, think about it logically for a second, you idiots. You know, let's, you know, cut out the bullshit, mate. The fans will be there on Saturday. That I'm absolutely certain of. It's just idiots, like I said before. They'll be there, mate. They will be there.
But taking the fans for granted proved to be a grave mistake. Just as they had warned, not a single fan turned up for the first game against the German tourists.
Incredibly, the fans had pulled together and demonstrated their collective power. This left the NZS with plenty of egg on their faces and a lot of explaining to do to the representatives of Werder Bremen Football Club.
Former Werder Bremen defender Gunnar Sorin recalls the moment.
Die Neuseelandreise war für uns ein Saisonende Tour.
We went to New Zealand on an end-of-season tour as the German season had finished. It was an honour to play against New Zealand. And more so because of Winton, a great player who had been with us for many seasons. What we witnessed in Auckland was unbelievable. Not one single supporter. The stadium was completely empty.
Damals fragten wir uns, ja, ob das Ganze vielleicht auf den Krieg
I remember us thinking that maybe this was because of the war.
Keiner wollte eine deutsche Mannschaft anschauen.
Of course, it was only afterwards we discovered it was a protest. For us, this was a great relief.
Für uns das war eine große Erleichterung.
The whole episode was a complete embarrassment, and the NZS crumbled. Simper was put in charge for the next game.
So incredibly, Ernest Simper, a football fan, was put in charge of the New Zealand national football team. And on the 1st of June 1992, Ernest Simper led New Zealand to an historic 2-1 victory against Werder Bremen in front of a sellout Wellington crowd.
Das, was wir beim nächsten Spielen erlebten, war unglaublich, einfach unglaublich.
What we witnessed in the next game was unbelievable. Not one empty seat. The stadium was completely full.
Damals nehmen wir an, dass dieser Mann, der Simper,
I remember us saying, this man, Simper, must be very important, so we must play our best. No one wanted to lose.
Aber das Geräusch der Fans im Stadion war wahnsinnig.
But the fans in the stadium were incredible. This helped New Zealand for sure. This is why they beat us.
Deswegen besiegten sie uns.
Simper also managed in the final game, a 1-1 draw. He had become the most unlikely national hero.
Kiwi soccer fans wanted Simper to carry on as manager, but Simper, who felt a point had been proven, turned his glory to his advantage, agreeing to stand down only if the NZS agreed to listen to the fans' viewpoint in the future. They did, and a new infrastructure for New Zealand soccer was born.
Marshall and Simper got over their differences, and although New Zealand failed to qualify for USA 94 in the penultimate playoff match, the team had made significant improvements. In 1998, New Zealand football fans finally had something to shout about. The All Whites beat fierce rivals Australia in their back garden to become Oceania champions. Sadly though, Ernest Simper, the man who had contributed so much to New Zealand football, was to miss this defining moment. Just months previously to the tournament, Ernest Simper had been killed in a car crash.
He was always on the road. His commitment, his passion to reach out to every football fan up and down the country, sadly contributed to Ernest Simper's death.
He was survived by his wife and his one son.
You know, he'd make his day, scored an early goal, the heads went down. And when they went 2-0 up, I have to say, you know, it was looking like a tall order, and I just thought that they wouldn't have the belief to come through. I mean, midfield wasn't the one passing the ball, there was massive gaps between the forwards and the backs, you know, where the midfield should be. We sat down with the lads and we had a chat with them at half time, which said, look, you know, you've got to have that belief, you've got to keep going. And, you know, basically, do you want it?
The Fans Cafe have devised an extra element to their fan candidate. They plan to conduct an experiment, using Warren as a virtual manager of the England football team during this summer's World Cup. The team feel this is a great opportunity to show the rulers of football that fans aren't stupid and do understand the game. But for the moment, Jason continues to struggle to get Bennett's application to be England manager officially registered.
I'm trying to get hold of Brian Barwick. Right, okay. Is he in meetings all the day? You know, every time I ring up, he's in a meeting. I know he's a busy man, but, you know, I've been trying to get hold of him. Look, basically, we've got somebody that we want to put forward for the England manager's job, and I wanted to know how we could do that. Is there a process? Or, right. So you can't help me then,
Do you know somebody that can help? There must be a process. You know, can I send in an email? Is there an application form that I have to send in? Right. Look at your website.
News of Bennett has spread, creating a minor wave of excitement. Although there is one question many are asking regarding his appointment.
I don't know how they chose him. I'm just happy they chose him. I don't know how they chose him. How do you think they may have chosen
him? Yeah, how many thousands of people would like to be like the manager of either their football team or their country?
I'd love to be.
I wouldn't put it in your hands the same way I would, to be honest.
There was a process involved, which the guys and I decided on, or the Fans Cafe decided on. But like I say, I don't think, you know, the actual process isn't important. You know, that's just something that happened in the background, and we really need to focus on going forward and getting Warren in a position where he can stand up and, you know, be counted for as one of the England managers, or one of the candidates for the England manager's job. That's the main thing. And then we, you know, look forward. We don't need to focus on, you know, how things were decided.
Yeah, it could have been that, like, that Big Brother style counselling or, you know, manager either, or a poll. Was it a poll between all the Fans Cafe and stuff? You don't know, man. But I like to think that they've obviously, they haven't just picked one out and said, oh, he'll do it, you know what I mean? They've obviously done some kind of background work.
Yeah. Hopefully
it doesn't mean so. The whole country are now looking towards this Bennett fellow. I just think it'd be fantastic if he can take us all the way to other glory.
We went through all the people that applied. Warren fitted the image and all the criteria best.
But when it came to the actual final decision, how did they cut down applicants?
If they have got a sieve through like 10,000 applications kind of thing, you like to think that they probably have, whatever process has been used, they have got done the best man of the job.
I really hope so, because it's either going to go two ways, isn't it? It's either going to give us a massive opportunity, or it's going to blow up in our face completely.
As you saw, I was just on the phone then, I'm trying to get him actually officially applying for the position of England manager. And I'm still very hopeful that they're going to consider him.
I'm trying to wreck my brains out to find out how they really did choose the manager. But if they're in touch with all 92 league clubs, and
I've also got to wonder, how did they choose those seven? That's the clubs who appointed those seven. Or that is those.
Bennett probably appointed those seven. Bennett probably appointed those seven, and then seven goes, I'll tell you what, we'll do for you, Bennett. Chung, I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll put you as the England manager.
The Fans Cafe decision to champion a fan to become the national team manager raises many questions. Managers and players come and go, but the fan remains, an element that stands out. When a fan chooses a club, they choose it for life. From a psychological point of view, the fan's mindset is very different to that of a manager's.
Being a football fan is an emotional roller coaster. In an average 90-minute game, the emotions can range from extreme highs to extreme lows. This is because a football fan, over a period of time, has developed very strong bonds with their clubs or the national team. And having these strong bonds, which is essentially a very intimate relationship, ultimately reduces the football fan's overall clarity of the game. This, of course, is part of the reason why football fans have such extreme viewpoints.
You're under 16, mate.
In order to refine a more neutral viewpoint, a football fan would need to create adequate distance between their strong bonds and the game. If the fan was able to create this distance, then they would be in a better position or mindset to give a more rounded opinion. For the case of this experiment, the fan would be able to make unrestricted or purer decisions.
That's it, Daddy.
Fill the box!
However, because the football fan has developed such a strong bond for their team or the national team, creating any distance is very difficult. The team has almost become part of them, a close family member, if you like. The football fan becomes a guardian over their club, or in this instance, the national team. And this, of course, leads to the football fan having such an extreme viewpoint. This is sometimes referred to as blinkered vision, looking at the situation through rose-tinted glasses, almost like a father defending his son.
No, that would be fine. Yeah, well, obviously, just don't push him too hard. Yeah, we just want to kind of toughen him up a bit. That'd be great.
Well, actually say that. If you could help him lose a few pounds as well. Yeah, I know. Yeah. No, I think his partner would appreciate that. No, that'd be great. Anyway, he'll be there first thing tomorrow morning. Yeah, thank you very much. Cheers for all your help. Bye-bye.
That was Sergeant Crow from our boot camp. What we've decided to do is send Warren off for a couple of days just to get him a bit toughened up and ready for the job as England manager. So I'm going to send him off for a couple of days, toughen him up. But I think after all of it, Warren will come back a better and a stronger man. I won't say bigger man because we're hoping he's going to come back a slighter man. Should be interesting. Oh, excuse me one moment, could be the FA. Good morning, Fans Cafe. Hi there, yes. Cappuccino? No, sorry, we're not that type of cafe. No. We're a fans cafe for football fans. No, it's not a cafe just for football fans. It's a fans cafe, so we're kind of a forum for football fans. No, so you can't get a bagel here, I'm afraid. No.
The Fans Cafe are fine-tuning the details in preparation of the Virtual Football Manager experiment. Neil and Scott have been given the task to find two well-known football pundits who will provide professional feedback on Bennett's performance throughout the experiment. Jason and Jenny continue working on the FA, who are yet to comment on any of the Fans Cafe matters. Whilst away at a special boot camp organised by Jason, Warren's long-standing partner, Lucy, talks about his great enthusiasm for football.
So ever since he'd had his knee injury and was unable to play anymore, the fact of being able to be even thought of to manage a team and to have that responsibility and the key things that go with it would be absolutely fantastic. And to have the support of the guys and the responsibility and try and take the team through to the finals. Everything he says about it is passionate and close to home and from the heart. So it's not something I understand or ever will understand, but it's what he enjoys, so absolutely very proud of him. He is, it's brilliant. Although a little annoying at times when football takes over everything, but I think that one man to have such a passion and to want to see others achieve with that passion, you can't knock him.
Neil and Scott have failed to secure any pundits so far. As a core element to the virtual manager experiment, without them, the experiment could be over before it has started. Their list of candidates is becoming very short. Nobody seems interested.
But
I'm sure he's... is that his agent?
Surely only talent.
Oh, hi, how are you doing? It's Scott here from the Fans Cafe. Yeah.
Come on.
I've left a few messages.
Andy can't be working this summer.
No, I know he's. I know he's a busy man. I appreciate he's a busy man. I mean, we've spoken a couple of times, and you know.
So that was our last choice then. So we didn't manage to get anybody. Nobody at all.
Nothing at all, and it's been like that all the way through.
I'm surprised that Steph didn't go.
Yeah, I thought was it Anton Deck or Wrighty that somebody got, you know, thought we nearly got them.
Well, Pele or Cruyff, you know, you would have thought.
What we have found several times talking to a few players. Maybe not as well respected as those, but just general people that we've got as consensus. And there appears to be a couple of individuals that keep popping up. Mm-hmm. I mean, we've not met with them yet. We don't really know enough about them.
Big names.
It's a long name. Stringfellow. And a little guy. Brian
Lewis.
They call him Little and Large.
Yeah.
But,
but how did you hear about them?
Their name kept cropping up in several conversations.
Any fixed up any time with them? Will we get a...
Yeah, well, that's the next step. We didn't want to just jump in and go ahead with two, complete unknowns, as it were, without putting it around the table.
That's where we chat to most of these guys. And,
sounds like we'll have to go for that anyway. Well, at least see if we can get them involved.
We said months ago, you know, we actually said maybe we need to get real fans doing the punditry on the fan, and so it's not something we haven't discussed. It's not a cold idea.
Let's try and get it sorted because we need to do something. I'm relying on you guys now because We seem to be scraping the barrel slightly, so we haven't got many other options. So let's get these guys in and then we can get the ball rolling.
Okay. Well, if we can't get them, we can always go to Bandy Townsend.
A couple of phone calls later that week, and the luck of the Fans Cafe seems to be changing for the better. Neil and Scott have secured two pundits.
I think they'd be really good. You know, they're very well sought after as well, so they, you know, we've got them ahead of a lot of other people as well, which is just fantastic.
And they've committed to be around during the experiment, because that's just my main concern.
But this is local for them. This is easily accessible. This is a good centre point for them. And that's our main selling point. So if they've got other avenues looking at them, then I don't see a problem.
These guys are wholeheartedly behind the experiment, and they know, you know, they know what we're trying to do. They know how we're going to go about it, and they're full, you know, they're 150% behind it.
Yeah. You don't look convinced, Jen.
I'm not.
No.
Not at all.
Well, we'll stand by our results. Yeah. And, we think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's been a week of mixed emotions for the Fans Cafe. Shortly after securing the pundits, the FA announced the appointment of a New England manager, meaning Bennett's application has failed. Having received no feedback from the FA, Jason is determined to continue with the experiment and prove the FA wrong. However, some members of the Fans Cafe are now starting to have serious doubts on what they can actually achieve.
No, seriously, don't worry at all. Everything will be fine. Yeah. Yeah, we're going to carry on, Yeah, it will be sorted. And I'm sure it'll be fine, so yeah. You go and enjoy your kebab and I'll speak to you soon, mate. Alright, take care. Bye-bye. Oh, it's been a tough week, it really has. Obviously, we've heard about the announcement. So, some of the team have got concerns, but I don't think it's an issue. The Fans Cafe is bigger than that decision. So, the experiment itself isn't what the Fans Cafe is all about. The Fans Cafe is bigger than the experiment as well. It's bigger than Consider Bennett. So I don't think we should worry. We're going to continue with the experiment. It's still going to be a very good success as far as I'm concerned. I'm still hopeful that the FA are going to get involved with the experiment as well. So yes, they've appointed another manager for the England team, but I still want them to get involved and actually see what this experiment's all about. And alongside that, find out more about the Fans Cafe and then perhaps get involved with us and we can work on this alliance. So, no, I'm still convinced we're going to go ahead with the experiment and we're going to, you know, carry on and it's going to be a success.
Jason Ellis wants football to consider the fans more evenly. In order to prove his point, his Fans Cafe movement have put an ordinary football fan, Warren Bennett, into one of football's most difficult jobs, that of the England manager. Bennett will manage England during the World Cup finals as part of an unprecedented virtual manager experiment.
How do you feel about what we've been trying to do with regards to get the FA and the football associations, etc., and the clubs to listen to the fans more?
It's the fans that actually drive the game, you know, and unfortunately, you know, we're kind of taking I count myself in that as a fan. We're taking for granted.
Definitely, yeah.
So I believe this experiment, which we're undertaking for the World Cup, it's an opportunity for us, us collectively,
yeah.
fans have got behind, yeah. got behind this experiment, get behind the team, and we can show the FA, you know, what we're about and what the fans are about.
What are your expectations for this virtual manager as during the World Cup competition? Are you expecting to take England all the way? Have you got any specific tactics that you're going to use?
Obviously, I've got my team in my mind. I've got the tactics for the first game.
Yeah.
Sometimes situations in games call for you to change the tactics slightly, so you can't really be sort of set in your ways and say, well, I'll tell you what, I'll play 4-4-2 and be rigid throughout the tournament. Having said that, I definitely think as England, you know, England play 4-4-2, or the players in England play 4-4-2
yeah.
week in, week out, that is our strongest formation. All the players are comfortable with it. However, we may need to adapt during certain situations in certain games, so. But yeah, I've got an idea in my mind for the games.
What do you see happening to yourself after this? Do you think this is going to elevate you anywhere else? And also, do you think this virtual manager thing might catch on and we could see it happening again in the future? Other countries are perhaps buying into it?
I haven't even thought any further ahead, as I said, than Saturday's game, really. As for what happens to me, you know, I don't know. So I think it's too early to tell.
An overprotective fans cafe have deliberately concealed the identity of the pundits until now. With Jason's consent, the film crew have set up a meeting at a nearby hotel to get an introduction from them and to discuss the experiment.
It should be interesting. It's very interesting. In terms of analysis, they're going to track the things he says and the things he thinks should change. And it'd be interesting if they could map how exactly that will have changed the game. So, for instance, half-time, if he said, you know, Rooney's not fit or Beckham not fit, he should have come off. And 20 minutes later, he's struggling or gotten that tackle or thing. Then we could say, right, Mr. Yeah. Warren had a good point. What's the point, Brian? Well, the whole point of the experiment is can a fan really run anything?
But we know that he can't already.
No.
We've already had the discussion.
That's the point of this experiment. Warren is going to be analysed game by game.
So if you've been playing professional football for 10 years and unknown from Sunday morning with a pot belly turns up and starts telling you you can play the Christmas tree formation, what are you going to say?
He may want to
leave. You listen to him. Are you going to pay for it? Are you going to pay for it?
This experiment is now saying, right, this cafe team have come up with Warren, but in reality, what could happen is that the whole of the nation could vote for a person that may not be in the Premiership, maybe First Division, Second Division, could be a Grady and Division 2, could be anyone. And let's go with the experiment.
So from what you know and what you've heard about Bennett in the past, you tell me why you think the public, Joe Public, are going to want Bennett to be England manager. Because England manager can't survive without the public liking him.
Exactly. Well, you know,
how are they going to like Bennett? You seen a photo of him?
This body has come up with him based on experience and know-how. And
which
we've
covered that. Which he hasn't got any.
Experience and know-how in football.
Yeah.
Maybe not in Premiership football, but in football. Okay.
He hasn't got any much of that either, from what I've been hearing. Because since our last...
You should give the boy a chance. In fact, giving the fan the chance to leave the England team is a good idea. I think there's all sorts of, you know, walks of our life where we rely on the public opinion, which is voting for the government.
Right, shut up.
You know, X Factor.
You rambling. I've been listening for the last 10 minutes.
Right.
None of it makes any sense to me.
No, okay. All right. Well,
you're being dumb.
No, okay.
Again. let's take two steps back, right?
There's a question over how Bennett's performance will be judged. The pundits will offer an opinion, but there appears to be nothing tangible to provide a definitive result. Jason has provided assurances that this is very much in hand, but he hasn't been forthcoming with any information. It's the morning of the first day of the experiment, and this afternoon, Bennett will take on Paraguay in his first match. Jason has decided not to spend the day with him, and has handed this responsibility down to Neil. He hopes this will raise Neil's spirits, as lately, Neil has been having serious doubts about the Fans Cafe's long-term goals.
Today's the day. This is what we've all been waiting for. We've got the first game against Paraguay later on this afternoon. And all the hard work that's been put in by myself and by the rest of the team is hopefully going to show some dividends this afternoon. I'm not going to see Warren today. He's actually with one of my colleagues, Neil. And he's going to be going through with Warren with regards to the tactics, the team that he's picked, etc. And then they're going to run through all of that, any changes he makes during the game, and then Neil's going to send those back to me via email. Warren's got the opportunity now to make a difference and to push his fans team or his experimental team as far through the World Cup as possible. So everybody's going to have to chip in. My team all going to be working hard. Warren's going to be working hard. And again, I think we're going to see the dividends.
Warren has received a surprise that may distract him from his England responsibilities. An old friend has travelled back from New Zealand just to offer him his support for the first match.
Jason, for his part and his wisdom, has asked me to look after Warren today. From my perspective, I thought that was pretty much going to involve me just supplying him with hot dogs and sausage rolls, but apparently there's a little bit more to it. I've been asked, amongst other things, to hand-hold him through his first day to make sure that everything is working according to plan, and really to collate his tactics to make sure that you know, what Warren's doing is captured so that we can feed it back at a later date.
Done my homework on the players. Scoured quite a few websites, looking at fans' forums. I think I generally, you know the feeling of the fans. I think that the opinions, although you know opinions differ, I think that the core fact is that the majority of the England team picks itself. I think that the fans know that, and what they want to see is they want to see a performance. They want to see England actually live up to the expectations. You know, there's a massive weight of expectation on England, and it's about time we delivered to the fans. I'm so excited about this tournament, and we are going to deliver. However, if I was to let my feelings actually get in the way, it could cloud my judgment. You know, I've got a vision and I've got a goal, and the emotions have to be put to one side. I know what I want, and I know how to deliver it.
Neil has successfully collated the data analysis on Warren's performance, but has failed to send any of the information over to Jason for processing.
He's been over for about an hour and a half now. I'm just waiting for an email from Neil now with all of the numbers from Warren with regards to the team that he's picked and the change that he's made. I'm going to read through the email just to make sure it looks okay before sending it off to the other team to process the results. And then obviously we just got to wait for the results to see how Warren's done. So just waiting for the results at the moment from Neil.
After a few drinks, Neil finally prepares the information for Jason.
It's been quite surprising. I thought he might struggle to keep his eye on the game today. His mate Curtis is over from New Zealand. He's over for the first time in a few years. And he's over specifically for these England games. And I personally, when I looked at Warren, thought, you know, you're not going to be focused today. But credit to the boy. Jace. Yes, mate, it's Neil.
Hello, Neil, yeah. Yeah, did enjoy the game, but I haven't got the results from you yet. Have you sent them through? You have sent them through, I still haven't got them, mate. Are you sure you've sent to the right email address?
Have you changed your email? Well, if you ain't changed it, it's in my favourites, then I've sent it, haven't I?
The team's waiting now, they need to process the results, so...
Maybe there's just a lot of traffic, you know, it's the World Wide Web, there'll be people on the world all over the place.
Well, I still haven't got it.
Wait, if I send it now, are you going to wait for it? Right, well, let me resend it to you. Right, it's gone, again.
Okay, hold on, let me just check. Yes, I've got it.
Oh, you got it now, have you? Yeah. Mate, you probably had too many big files in there or something. Alright, well, look, I'm going to get back to the guys and have a few drinks.
Go and enjoy the rest of your evening. Yeah. Yeah, I'll let you know what the team says.
Alright, cheers. Bye. Muppet.
It's good news for the Fans Cafe's virtual manager experiment. Warren's performance data has been analysed and he has won his first match. This is a big boost for the team. But as the team and the fans prepare for game two, the question over how this result is being processed is becoming more significant. Jason has decided to reveal the mechanism.
I was chatting to a friend of mine and he introduced me to the two guys from Verdict Pro. We sat down and had a chat about the tool. And I was very impressed. The guys themselves are really big football fans, which obviously we're about the Fans Cafe and all about getting behind the fans. They were trying to get this tool off the ground. So, you know, we thought we could kind of help them get that going and they would let us use the tool for a reasonable price. And so we thought we'd kind of take it from there. The pundits, which are very, very good. But it's their opinion, it's like your opinion and my opinion, it's, you know, everybody's got their own opinion. So it's not actually fact-based, it's not actually data-based, whereas Verdict Pro, the tool is, which is very, very useful. So like I say, going forward, we're going to use the tool, and it's something that we can take to the FA and we can show to them the numbers, the figures, the results. And I think that will be very, very good backing for Bennett.
Adam Davinsky and Dom de Villiers both studied business management at university. Together, they undertook a thesis on sports management, which drew their attentions to the sizeable money being invested into football. They took on a side venture and created a computer program that can accurately predict patterns and flows within the game,
enabling coaches to improve their decision making and reduce the risk of defeat, thus increasing financial turnover.
Well, when we were at uni, you had a thesis to do. It's quite complicated to do with some of the sort of back end stuff to do with this, and we just started working on it, and gradually the idea expanded, it got bigger, and you know, football, there's a lot of money in football, and we thought, why run up student debts when we can work on this?
We swapped tools. I gave Adam mine, he gave me his. We kind of played around with them a little bit.
Yeah.
And we found that, you know, when we put them together, we came up with this tool. We found there was a kind of a big fissure, a big crack in the market, and the bits and pieces that we have, in the football market, that's right. And when we put our tools together, we found that we actually had a tool to fill this crack.
Verdict Pro is brilliant, to be honest.
Yeah.
I mean, it allows you to do so much. It allows you to learn from your mistakes. You can see where you went wrong in the last game.
Yeah.
In our new version, the touchline version, you can say, you know, big game, you're drawing, FA Cup final perhaps.
Yeah.
You got 20 minutes to go, you're thinking, oh, in 10 minutes time, if it's still a draw, I'm going to have to make a decision, but do I bring on another striker? Do I block the midfield? It doesn't really matter to us, does it? And you just put the information in.
Yeah.
Verdict Pro touchline will tell you the best decision to make.
Yeah, to 99.7%
accuracy.
That the one of those options is going to give you a positive result. So, you know, I think it takes a lot of the guesswork out of the game.
We're only providing a tool. I mean, people have often asked us, well, what if both teams had Verdict Pro? What would happen then?
Mm.
You know, well, we're only helping you make the decisions you've already thought of.
Yeah.
We're not thinking up decisions for you. You can be rubbish, use Verdict Pro, and we'll just tell you which is the best rubbish option
that's
you've
right.
got.
Yeah, that's a really good way of putting it, actually.
It's not, but that we don't really care, to be honest. It's like people say, why did you work with Namibian national team? Well, it doesn't really matter to us which team. Well, if they're paying, we'll
get involved. Yeah, I mean, you know, let's be honest about this. We saw an opportunity to make money from the football world, because there is so much money in it anyway.
Clubs need to stay in the Premiership, for example, and they need to stay in the Champions League to fund the payrolls and to keep players and to keep the profiles. And I think that, you know, any club with any sense would invest in Verdict Pro to help them do that.
Absolutely.
Verdict Pro is so accurate, you could almost say it could predict the future.
It could. I reckon given a bit of time.
Yeah, we could make that work.
Predict the future.
Yeah.
Bennett is up against World Cup first-timers Trinidad and Tobago. He is asked to watch the match alone, agreeing to phone through his tactics and changes as they occur to Jason, who is spending the game with the Verdict Pro consultants. The consultants have coded in all of the predetermined information, along with Bennett's pre-game data and the match's real data. As the game progresses, Warren will phone through his decisions to Jason.
Yeah.
Jason will note them.
Right, I'll let them know. Pass it on. Cheers.
Pass the notes on to a consultant. The consultant will input the data into the Verdict Pro, allowing analysis from the Verdict Pro to provide an instant snapshot as to how Bennett's England team is performing.
Yes! Yes. Crouch!
It's been a very tense match. Warren has no idea how he is performing and is feeling the pressure. Tension is shared by the fans. Warren needs to release some nervous energy and right on cue, he gets his chance. Final whistle, which is a pleasing moment for the exhausted Verdict Pro consultants.
Good job.
The initial data analysis is very good. The real-time predicted result has adjudged Bennett to have won the match very comfortably, making it 2 wins out of 2. The Fans Cafe's virtual football manager experiment is gaining some momentum. However, one of the pundits isn't impressed. He questions the validity of the computer software and believes Warren has been very lucky. Winning 2 matches, he was expected to win anyhow. But a 3rd win in a row against a very good Swedish side means Bennett has guided England into the knockout stages. Adding greater strength to the Fans Cafe's argument, this prompts Jason into some impulsive action.
Well, the good news is we've qualified through the group stages and we've got Ecuador in the next round. I've been trying to get in touch with the FA, keep ringing them, keep emailing them, and I'm not getting any luck. The experiment's going really well, but they're not listening to anything. So we've decided actually to take the bull by the horns, as they say, and we're actually going up to the FA today. Hopefully we're going to get in touch with a few people. I've called and emailed them to say that we're coming up today and can they spare some time. Haven't had any responses at all, so we're going to go up there and see what we can sort out. here we are, we're at the FA now. It's just behind me. I'm going to pop in and see if I can get 10 minutes with Brian Barwick to have a chat about the experiments, and also to find out why they haven't been keeping in touch with us with regards to the emails and the phone calls that we've been sending to them. So, yeah, just want to find out and try and see if we can build some bridges with them now, because this experiment isn't just about the fans, it's also about the FA. We want their collaboration, we want some help. So it's going well. We're through to the next round of the World Cup. I've got all the facts with me. Hopefully I'll be able to get 10 minutes and take it from there, and it will be a success. So I'll speak to you in a few minutes. Cheers.
Bennett's England are set to fight it out with an impressive Ecuadorian side to win a place in the World Cup quarter-finals.
How do you feel the experiment's been going so far in the group stages, or up until now anyway?
It's gone well to date. Unfortunately, Michael Owen's out. However, you know, my squad, there was a ready-made replacement in Jermaine Defoe.
How further do you see England going all the way?
I don't really want to talk about anything further than today. You've got to concentrate on what's in front of you. If you underestimate this team, I mean, don't forget this team qualified in South America, where you have the Argentinians, your Brazilians, the Paraguayans. I just think that you shouldn't look further than today. It's going to be a very, very hard game. We need to play to our full potential, but we will do it if we do that.
Virtual football manager experiment is going well. Bennett remains grounded. Jason is very pleased with his performance so far. But what do the fans think about Bennett?
One thing I like about Bennett is he does talk to the fans' voices, you know what I mean? As in, he always talks with like how we'd talk if we were in the
game. Definitely, at least he's like trying to put some attacking players on when the game's not going so well, and we're actually going to try and win the game at the moment.
Can he continue to do that in the later stages of this World Cup? Yeah, for example, when we're playing like better teams like maybe the Brazil, the France, the Italy and stuff, can you afford to start to throw on Defoe and Ashton as well as Rooney and stuff like that?
If you come out of a game losing narrowly, but you've really gone for it, like Bennett seems to be making our players do, if you sit back, like we've done in previous tournaments, we've got every right to complain. Yeah. But if we actually go to win, if we go to win every game, if we lose, then at least we've actually gone out to win it.
And I feel one thing about Bennett though is, if we do go out this World Cup before the final, I can imagine us going out fighting. I can imagine us with the kind of person, he's the kind of player, where you're doing that in like a football management game on a PC or something, where he would throw four or five strikers on there if he had four or five strikers.
We can see this fans cafe working though, isn't it? A genuine fan taking England so far already with three very positive results.
Yeah, it's
really nice. Yeah,
I think it's fantastic. But then we can't get too carried away. We're only in the second round now. If we lose against Ecuador in the second round, then obviously this probably wouldn't have worked, and you'd have to look at this World Cup as a favourite.
So
we'll have to see how it gets on the later stages. But so far, so good. Three wins.
The fans seem happy as well. But has Bennett convinced the professionals that he is up to the job?
If we look at Bennett during England's first game of the World Cup against Paraguay, you can see that he is in deep concentration. His eyes rarely move from the action, and there's limited movement from him overall. He's completely submersed himself into the action, almost analysing every single detail. When in comparison, if we look at his friend on the left, he is consistently moving, chatting throughout the game. He is actually spending more time not watching the game. This suggests to me that Bennett has actually created the necessary distance from his strong ones for the national team. This will ensure that his decision making will be purer than the average football fan. Bennett is calm, composed. We can trust that he will make good decisions. In the case of this experiment, decisions that are made in the best interests of the team. Doing this, Bennett has proven he is a bona fide candidate for any potential management vacancy for the national football team. This vindicates the Fans Cafe decision to champion Bennett as the fan to do the job.
to what about the so-called experts?
He hasn't changed the formation of the two games. I think he had an opportunity to do that against mediocre opposition. He also had an opportunity to blood some other the younger players, because you know I think that you know our B team, our C team would beat Trinidad and Tobago. Let's be honest. I think that now we get past the group stages. I think that we come to the real teams, real coaches. They're going to be clever enough to change games in the middle of the 90 minutes and several times, not just once. And I think at the moment Ben doesn't know, hasn't shown in any of his group games. Sweden, he could have experimented. Yeah, he played Carrick, but he still played 4-4-2. He lacks imagination and he picks according to his heart, not according to practical reasons.
The shot struck Ferdinand. Beckham. Can he pick out Rooney? Rooney.
Come on, Joe!
Oh, it's a free kick just outside the area.
Yeah, I think Lampard tries to go through the middle of two defenders this time.
Now, if those two get ready, David Beckham has a free kick. Joe Cole's mixing with them.
Right, 1-0, Wingham. 1-0, 1-0.
Come on.
1-0.
Bennett has done it again. It's 4 wins out of 4. All seems to be going really well, when some disturbing news comes to light that may blow the whole experiment apart. Bennett may not be who he seems. Fans Cafe have a problem.
He's meant to be a Kiwi, isn't he?
Is he?
Yeah, that
screws the whole project up.
The whole experiment's out the window, if that's the case.
I don't know how true it is. Have you heard it?
I heard rumblings, but I wasn't sure. Oh. I thought we'd researched it all.
No, I was pretty sure he was English.
I noticed he never has the lamb.
No, I know.
To the slaughter, isn't it?
It's probably related to a couple of them or something.
Yeah.
It's almost
Jesus, what are we going to do now? Just chasing them. Jason's going to go mineral. He doesn't like Kiwis, does he?
Yeah, but he's only going to go mental in a very nice way, isn't he? You know, he's,
well, there's talk that Warren Bennett could actually... There's any rumours that none of us actually know, but I don't know. But he could actually be from New Zealand, and I don't really quite sheep shack.
For me, Stringy, yeah, whether he's Kiwi or not makes no difference.
Beginning of the World Cup, if we'd have said, "Oh yeah, we've got a vote, we can vote for this new manager," if he was a Kiwi, and we knew that beginning, you would never ever recognise him.
The whole experiment was a sham, and I think that we should, let's do something about it now before the media get all over this.
If we go out against Portugal in a 3-0 defeat or something like that, and we've been absolutely rotten, I think people are going to be saying,
as long as he wins the World Cup, no one's going to.
I listened to the whole ethos around the fans cafe, having a fan as the manager. Now, having a fan means that you're passionate about England. You're English and you understand the English game from a fan's perspective. How can he, well, he's a sheep shagger?
Yeah, I've heard the rumours as well, but I don't think there's anything to worry about.
Excuse me, Jason, this could blow the whole, you know, the press obviously getting onto it, and this could blow the whole experiment.
No, I don't agree.
Well, the thing was, he's meant to be wholesome, he's, you know, and he's meant to be English. That was the other part of the idea. This comes out and he's a Kiwi.
Yeah. So you think we should just, like, fold, yeah?
No,
just
forget about it. Fold. You need to address this.
Yeah, and I will do. I'll have a word with Warren. But like I say, we can't just stop every time we come across, you know, something that's going to get in our way. We need to keep carrying on. You know, we've got to push through this, so...
Yeah, I just think the problem is, if this gets proven, that, you know, what do people from New Zealand know about football?
The experiment is about seeing how somebody can do, you know, a fan can do as being an England manager. So if it does come, you know, turn out to be true, you know, it's going to look not particularly great, but if the experiment itself is successful, I don't think it'll be thought about. You know, people might worry about that. It's just, like I say, we can't just stop every time something goes wrong. Let's just push on with our objective. Let's get through this. I'll have a word with Warren. We'll sort it all out, you know, see if it's true or not, and then we'll carry on.
Jason has taken Warren to one side to have a serious conversation about the rumours circulating about him. Jason refused to allow the cameras to document this chat.
I really don't know what the fuss is all about. I had the conversation with Warren before the experiment started. I've brought it up with him again, and he's assured me he's 100% English, he's 100% behind England, and he's got nothing to do with New Zealand. I think he may have been there on holiday once, but he's English 100% through and through. I think there's just some people that want to get at the experiment now, because we're doing really well. They just want to get at us, they want to get at Warren, or they're using Warren as an avenue to get at the experiment, just because he's been successful, as people always do, trying to knock him down a peg or two. I think we're in the quarterfinals, end of story. I don't think we need to talk about New Zealand anymore.
It's game 5. Warren's England will battle against a much fancied Portuguese side for a place in the last 4 of football's greatest competition. The experiment continues to attract criticism, mainly due to the many doubters of the Verdict Pro Tools' validity, whilst others believe Warren has just been plain lucky.
I actually think you know what you're doing, and any, you know, the decisions you've made, the teams that you've picked, do you think that's made a difference, or kind of, you know, or has it just been luck? Has it just been luck that we've got so, you know, as far as we have?
If you look down the years, I think obviously you need an element of luck to win the World Cup, but predominantly there have been judgment calls, you know. To actually say, has it been luck, I think is quite disrespectful, but, you know, I understand you've got to ask the question. I think the tactics have been more or less spot on. There are a couple of things maybe could have changed, could have tweaked with, but, you know, overall I'm happy. I'm not happy with the performances, but the fact is, we won the games, we're in the quarterfinals, and you're sitting there talking to me about it.
Yeah.
Come on, England! Come on!
Tense affair for the fans cafe so far. So much so, in fact, that immediately after the game, Neil has resigned. Jason has decided to delay Warren's result for a couple of days.
After the Portugal game, Neil just decided that he wanted to retire, or he wanted to leave the fans cafe. He just felt that, you know, he'd had enough, but you know, he could see that the fans cafe was being a success with regards to this experiment. But at the time he decided. But yeah, it's a big disappointment for the fans cafe. He's been a member for a while. He's always got some really valuable input, you know, he knows his stuff. And he's always been very enthusiastic with taking the cause forward. You know, so, you know, he's going to be a great loss. We're still talking to him, maybe we can talk him round.
Neil's closest fans cafe confidant, Scott, tries to explain Neil's actions.
On a personal note, I'm quite disappointed really. Neil and I have worked together on this project for quite some time. And, you know, he's a good lad. I really have enjoyed his company and got on well. We've sort of built up a good friendship as well, so I'm going to miss that. His reasons, I think, you know, he's been in this project for some time. And prior to this project, he's worked in other sort of movements. And he's always getting knocked back. He's always feeling like, you know, the bodies, the big governing bodies like the FA have got a thing against people like, you know, the fans, the people that are paying the ticket, you know, we pay high prices in tickets, we pay for, you know, the schedules of TVs around the big bodies, the governing bodies that are earning the money, and it's just a frustration for him. And I think that frustration over the last, I think it's several years now, has really, really grown, and just, you know, it's been a nail in the coffin. I think the experiment's been a success, which is good news, but I certainly don't think that this experience for him has been a fantastic one. And as I say, I'm quite, you know, disappointed. Neil and I, Hodgie and I, on a personal level, got on really well. We have a bit of banter in the office as well. We can have a bit of a giggle. We take, you know, the piss out of Jason when he's not there and stuff like that, which is good fun. At this moment in time, I think Neil's got to do what he's got to do. You know, we try to convince him that there's a place for him to continue here, but he's too despondent for that. So,
quarterfinal was played 2 days ago, and it's been an anxious wait for Warren. Jason is due to receive the result at any moment and has promised Warren a call straight away.
Hi there. You got the results. Great. Thanks very much. Cheers. Bye-bye.
Okay, Warren, where are you?
This is it. Hello? Hello, Jason.
I've got some news for you. Guess what? You won.
Oh, that's great news. Excellent. Absolutely superb. Come on.
You need to start thinking about the French game now. Yeah. Gotta start planning for that. Think about your team, etc.
Agreed. It's not going to be easy. Obviously, we've got no Beckham. No Owen. Terry's ruled out as well.
Now that's a very good point. Obviously, you've got quite a few players out now through suspension and injury, so it's going to be a bit of a tester.
Zidane looks world class, you know, we know he's world class. He's definitely going to be the danger man.
Yes, he will be. He will be definitely as well, I agree. Yeah, so what we do is I'll let you go away and have a think about what you're going to do next. Obviously, you'll probably want to celebrate as well the good news. But yeah, we need to sort some time out together, so if we can do that. That'd be really good. And just on a personal note, I really want to thank you for the hard work that you've put in. And also, so I really appreciate all your help and all your efforts. Yeah, well, you have a lovely evening. Enjoy yourself.
I will enjoy this evening. Maybe have a beer or two, eh? Definitely. I'll give you a call in the morning. Thanks for the news, Jason. And you, mate. Cheers. Bye-bye. Oh, get in there.
Fans have been giving Bennett all the way, and he has rewarded them with a World Cup semi-final. However, questions over the verdict Pro Tour continue to cloud the success of the experiment, and Jason is beginning to feel the pressure.
To be quite honest, I'm just getting really fed up with all these questions, all these queries about the verdict Pro stuff. It's just doing my head in. There's more important things to worry about. It's what it's all about. I think, you know, if you look at it closer, people are getting on the back of Verdict Pro because our experiment has gone further than the actual England team. We're on the eve of playing France in the next round, and people are just getting on our backs because of that and blaming Verdict Pro. When Beckham got injured and Bennett decided that he was going to bring on Dean Ashton, he changed the formation to a 4-4-2, and it totally changed the game. Really, really did. It gave Rooney the space that he needed. He got more creative. And, you know, it just kind of turned the game around for England. And I think if you kind of sum it up, Bennett has got more balls than Sven, and that's what people are worried about, and that's what people don't like seeing. The game in life is made of margins, you know, some big, some small. And if you want to kind of put a bit of a pun on it, you could say that Bennett's balls are marginally bigger than Sven-Goran Eriksson's. Verdict Pro is 99.7% accurate there. People need to start having faith in it. I trust it, I have faith in it. Other people need to start doing that as well. Like I say, I'm just getting fed up with these questions, you know. We're on the eve of the France game. I just want to get on with it now.
Warren Bennett, a working class fan with the assistance of state-of-the-art technology, has guided the England football team to a World Cup semi-final. A feat only ever achieved twice before him by the great Sir Ralph Ramsey and Sir Bobby Robson. Bennett's achievement has stood him in legendary company. Does Bennett go on to further greatness? Does he beat France? Does he lead England to a World Cup final? The point of the experiment was to prove to football's governing bodies that fans are not stupid, and when given the opportunity, they can make a meaningful contribution to shaping the future of the game. Bennett has been a success, however, there will always be doubters.
And in the end of the day, also, I don't think the England fans are truly behind him because he's from New Zealand. Sorry, but that's, you know, at the end of the day, I think is a, if you're going to be a fan of the English football team, then you've got to be English. You've got to be born and bred in the home counties, mate.
Imagine, if you can, our rich football megastars of today playing in empty grounds. They would no longer be rich financially from football, and they most definitely would not be megastars. Fans have contributed so much to football that it seems implausible that they should be taken advantage of. Football owes the fans a great debt, and whilst the fans most certainly need football, football itself desperately needs the fans. Atmospheres enjoyed at football matches across the land are created by fans. Fans are the fabric of football. Without them, what would football be? With increasing ticket prices and greater than ever TV and media control, how much further can the fans be pushed before there is a reaction? So, is the concept of a fans cafe the way forward for football fans? Will it help to allow them to have a meaningful say in the way football is governed? Only time will tell.
Come back to what you know. Take everything real slow. I wanna lose you, but I can't let you go. Before you interfere, let me make it loud and clear that you got no more to prove. Take it easy on yourself. There's nothing new about regretting how you felt. I'll never let you down or ever feel the way that I've been fearing now. I'm coming back to what you know. Got keep it safe. Hang on to what you got.